All right, so this is the last session on research design. Today, we're going to talk about two things, using interviewing to collect qualitative data, and three non-probability sampling methods, convenience, judgmental, and snowballing. There are many instruments we can use to collect qualitative data, but the most common one has to be interviewing. Generally speaking, interviewing comes in three flavors, unstructured or in-depth interviews, semi-structured or focused interviews, and structured interviews. Unstructured interviews are used for highly exploratory purposes. In the past sessions, we talked about how exploratory studies are usually qualitative. We talked about why exploratory studies do not need to be accurate or precise. And we talked about what exploratory means. When a study is highly exploratory, we are primarily interested in letting previously unknown issues or perspectives surface. Unstructured interviews are very useful for highly exploratory research. In other words, we do not have a predetermined set of questions to go through with the interviewee. Instead, we let the conversation run its course and take us wherever it does. Essentially, the researcher will go into the interview with a research objective in mind. The researcher may have a few questions pre-formulated, but there are no specific orders, and these questions can also change substantially during the process of interviewing. So basically, we go in with a completely open mind and let the answers from the interviewee take us on an exploratory adventure, so to speak. And we ask new questions on the basis of what the interviewee has just told us. So clearly, it takes an experienced researcher to be able to do unstructured interviews well. Semi-structured interviews, obviously, would have more of a structure. We have some of the interview questions pre-formulated on the basis of the research questions, but we do leave plenty of room for improvisation. We can add additional questions, and we can also put in follow-up questions in the process of interviewing. As we put more and more structure into the interview will ultimately become a structured one. In a structured interview, we ask predetermined questions. We ask the same questions to all interviewees. But regardless if we use unstructured, semi-structured, or structured interviews, the general idea behind interviewing is that we ask open questions during the interview. So instead of asking closed questions such as, do you like research, we should ask, what do you think about research? What's your opinion or experience regarding doing research as a bachelor student? And we can follow things up with, please elaborate on what you just said regarding something. Or can you explain in more detail what you meant with something? Because ultimately, we want to trigger unexpected, previously unknown perspectives through interviewing. Another important question regarding interviewing or qualitative research in general is, how big should the sample be? How many people should I interview? Obviously, as it is the case with many research design-related questions, the answer to this question is also, it depends. It depends on many factors, but a very important consideration is whether our interviewing has achieved saturation in data collection. In other words, when we no longer hear new perspectives anymore coming from the answers given by the interviewee, when everything that can be covered has been covered in relation to the main research questions, that is when we stop the individual interview or the overall interviewing process. All right, that's it about interviews for now. The textbooks we're using, so Verhoeven and Brotherton, also present a few other qualitative data collection instruments. So qualitative observation, focus group, action research, and projective techniques. So if you're interested, please give them a quick read. I have also covered some of these instruments in my other videos, which I will link on the screen and also at the end of this video. And now we can move on to sampling. Qualitative studies generally call for a relatively small sample, and non-probability sampling methods are perfectly acceptable for most qualitative research. The reason for this is that qualitative research is usually less concerned with generalizability and representativeness. So let's take a look at three non-probability sampling methods here. This chapter also presents a few non-probability sampling procedures. The first is convenience sample. This basically means that the researcher takes a sample based on considerations of what is easy and convenient. If I need 10 people as a sample, and I happen to have 10 people in this class, I can just take these 10 people. That is a convenient sample. Now, is this sample truly representative of the entire population? Well, I don't care. But is that okay? Sure, it is okay in some situations if your population is very homogenous, or if representativeness is simply not a major concern for you, like in certain exploratory studies, then a convenience sample is perfectly acceptable. The second one is called judgmental sampling. This means the researcher will set up a list of criteria and then judge who he or she wants to include as part of the sample for a specific study. For example, if my study calls for collecting data from individuals who must fulfill a certain combination of characteristics or experiences, then judgmental sampling might be very useful. The third one is called snowball sampling or snowballing. Essentially, this means if I can locate one person who would qualify to be included as part of the sample, I will ask him or her to introduce me to more people like him or her who might also be able to fulfill the criteria that I have set forth for selecting the sample. All right, at this point, we have covered everything mentioned in the module book. You can now finalize your research design paper for your module assignment.